Okay, so we will begin with the first PhD seminar given by Javier Carrascosta Tejedor. He's a first-year student, as the slide indicates, in the LSS group. He will describe the members of his team. I'll simply tell you what the title is: Controlling Reservoir Formation at the Air-Water Interface by Nanoparticle Design. So thank you very much, Javier, and please begin.
Thanks, Henry, for the introduction, and good afternoon, everyone. Well, my name is Javier Carrascosa, and well, in this presentation, I'm going to talk to you about the project that I'm working on, which is mainly centered in the control of reservoir formation at the air-water interface by nanoparticle design. And this is a project between the University of Manchester and the ILL. My supervisors are Jane Lawrence and Richard Campbell from the University of Manchester and Armando Maestro from the ILL. So first of all, I want to give you an outlook of this presentation, just to keep things organized. And I will begin with an introduction in which, since I am working with oppositely charged polyelectrolyte surfactant mixtures, I will begin explaining what surfactants and polyelectrolytes are. Then I will go on to explain the oppositely charged PS mixtures and their main properties. And then I will explain also an analogy of some of these systems with the Lang surfactant dynamics. So after that, I will mention which are the objectives of this project. Then I will explain the materials and methods that we have used in this project. And after that, I will present the main results that we have obtained till now for the system of study, which is polyelectrolyzing and sodium glycine sulfate. And finally, I will conclude with the perspectives of this project. So first of all, what are surfactants? Surfactants are amphiphilic molecules that are composed by two different parts. One is the polar head, which is hydrophilic, and the other moiety is composed by a hydrophobic chain, which is generally a hydrocarbon chain, and it's nonpolar. The head can be ionic or non-ionic, and the main properties of this kind of molecules is that they are strongly adsorbed at interfaces. That is, that they have surface activity, and they provoke a reduction of the interfacial tension, which is the variation of the Gibbs free energy as a function of the variation of the area. And then this surface tension is directly related with the amount of material present at the interface. You can see here a graph and a sketch in which I present a surface tension isotherm. We can begin here in this point with the surface tension of the water around 72. And then as we add surfactants to the solution, the surface tension decreases until we reach this point in which the interface is saturated, the surface tension remains constant, and supramolecular aggregates start to appear in the solution, such as micelles. And this is known as the critical micelle concentration. Polyelectrolytes are polymers, that is, macromolecules that are composed by repetitive units throughout a chain, and they can be cationic, anionic, or svitterionic. And then the dissociation of these groups can be pHT dependent or not. There are different classifications, but I want you to keep in mind these two. The main properties of these molecules, and more in the context of this project, is that they are not surface active. And then they have a strong electrostatic interaction with oppositely charged surfaces and molecules, such as the surfactant. And then it's important to mention that the pH and the ionic strength can have high influence on the properties of these molecules. Then I wanted to mention that many biologically relevant molecules are polyelectrolytes, such as the proteins or the DNA, the RNA. And then understanding the behavior and the properties of polyelectrolytes, it can help us to understand the properties of these molecules and find new applications of these molecules. Well, we go now to the oppositely charged polyelectrolyte surfactant mixtures. They have been widely studied due to their numerous applications and for example, cosmetics and detergents, but also drug delivery applications. And it's very important to understand the properties of these mixtures in the bulk, in the solution, in order to understand their interfacial properties. So here you have an sketch with the equilibrium behavior of these mixtures. Basically, if we keep constant the concentration of polyelectrolyte and we add the surfactant, we will reach this point in which we have undercharged aggregates in a one-phase region. But then, when we are getting close to the neutrality point, we have some aggregates that are with neutral charge, and precipitation can occur, and therefore phase separation. But if we continue increasing the concentration of surfactant, we can inverse the charge of this aggregate in such a way that they are hydrophilic again and they can be redissolved in the solution. But there are some non-equilibrium effects that are key in the sample preparation. See, as you can see here, there is some influence on the order of addition of the polyelectrolyte or the surfactant in the final state of the solution. And this is key in our project. Then mention that the oppositely charged PS mixtures has a strong interactions. So I wanted to give some of the direct background of my project because it's continuing some work that Andrea Tumino did in his ILL PhD. And well, he studied some mixtures of sodium polystyrene sulfonate and of the citrate methyl ammonium bromide at the air water interface. So first of all, they exploited the non-equilibrium effects that appear in the behavior of these systems to form spread films at the air water interface. And they demonstrated in this, you can see it in these two graphs, which are just measurements of the amount of material as a function of the time, that the spread films, in the spread fields, the amount of material at the interface is much higher than in the case of adsorbed films, where they waited to the aggregates to adsorb at the interface. Then they studied the dynamic behavior of these aggregates at the air water interface, and they saw that for positively charged aggregates, there were the creation of extended extractors that you can see on a sketch here. And in the case of negatively charged aggregates and high ionic strength, these extended extractors didn't appear. They could demonstrate this by measurements of ellipsometry, surface pressure, and neutron reflectometry, which is key in this project. So one of the main conclusions is that it is possible to tune the charge and the extractor of the aggregates in such a way that we can activate or deactivate the formation of extended extractors at the air-water interface. So what is important here that there is an analogy of these PS mixtures with the lung surfactant dynamics. The lung surfactant is a mixture of lipids and protein, which is vital for the stabilization of the alveoli during the breathing process. So it is composed by 90% of lipids, which are the responsible of the reduction of the surface tension, and 10% of proteins, which are very important to the formation of the reservoirs. You can see here in a sketch in which when we apply a compression, there is the formation of these kind of structures, and when the expansion occurs, this material returns to the interface. So this is the analogy that they saw with the NAPSS DTAP system. So now the objectives of our project are, first of all, continue exploiting the non-equilibrium effects of PX mixtures to obtain spread films at the air-water interface that can have potential to form extended extractors at the air-water interface. Then extend the developed spread film methodology to more biologically relevant systems that can be potentially used in pharmaceutical applications. And finally, we want to study different approaches to tune the properties of these films. First of all, modifying the pH and the ionic strength of the medium, and then using also gold nanoparticles with different shape, size, shares, and functionalization. So, we choose a system composed by polyl lysine and sodium lysyl sulfate. And as I won't mention, trying to go to more biocompatible systems or more biologically relevant systems is one of the objectives of this project. So one of the main considerations to choose this system was to choose a positively charged polyelectrolyte in such a way that we can avoid the use of positively charged surfactants, which are highly toxic. And then we chose SDS because it's used up to 1% in oral formulations, and PLL because polyamino acids are biodegradable, they have low toxicity, and PLL has been used in drug release applications. So now I'm going to explain a little bit the sample preparation, and it's simple, but at the same time, it's crucial for our study. What we do is prepare two different solutions of surfactant and polyelectrolyte at double their final concentration in the same volume of water. Then we mix these two solutions, adding the surfactant mixed solution at the to the polyelectrolyte solution very fast, and then we wait a little bit with a magnetic stirrer to create these mixtures in such a way that we can obtain the PS aggregates that then we can spread at the air-water interface, and we have to do it quickly in order to avoid the precipitation of the aggregates. Now I'm going to explain the techniques that we have been used and why do we use and what is the objective of each technique. First of all, we use the zeta potential measurements to determine the charge of these PS aggregates, and then also to determine the charge neutrality point. And as I was mentioned before, charge is a key point for the formation of extended extractors. So these measurements are quite important for this project. In order to do an experiment of zeta potential, it's simple. You just have to put your solution in this cell, which is has two different electrodes, one positive and one negative, and you apply a voltage, and depending on the charge of the aggregates, they will go towards the positive or the negative electrode, and we can measure the electrophoretic mobility of these particles, which is directly related with this zeta potential or the surface or the surface charge of these aggregates. For the surface tension measurements, we use a Langmuir trough, which is schematized in this figure. And actually, we measure the surface pressure, which is just the difference between the surface tension of the water and the surface tension of the interface with our film. So we spread these aggregates between these two barriers. We wait for the equilibration of the film, and we can measure the pressure with this sensor. And then this is important because we can study the dynamic behavior of this system by compressing and expanding the layer with these two barriers. Then we use ellipsometry, which is an optical technique that is very sensitive to the amount of material at the interface. So we use linearly polarized light that incides into the interface at a certain angle of incidence, and we can obtain elliptically polarized light from the interaction of this light with our film in such a way that measuring these changes of polarization, we can obtain information about the refractive index and the thickness of our film. This change of polarization is defined by the ellipticity, which depends on the reflectivity coefficients, and at the same time, it depends on these two angles, C and delta. Delta is the phase difference between the reflected and the incident beam, and C is the ratio of the amplitudes. So it's important to mention that the sensitivity of delta respect to C is much higher for thin films at the air-water interface. So that's the reason why I will only present the data of the delta. We are going to do measurements at a constant angle of incidence. This means that we can have time results measurements of the surface excess of the amount of material present at the interface. And we can calculate it by this formula. Then mention that we can couple the Langmuir trough to the ellipsometer in such a way that we can do dynamic measurements of the ellipsometry. So now I'm going to explain a bit neutron reflectometry. I haven't used it yet for my project, but as I was mentioning before, it's key for the study of these films. So we have an incoming neutron beam, a reflected neutron beam, and this is QZ, the momentum transfer that is defined by the difference of the wave vectors, incident and reflected, and depends on the wavelength and the angle of incidence. So we will use specular reflectivity, which means that the angle of incidence and the angle of reflection are exactly the same. And with this technique, we can obtain information about the structure and the composition of the films. One of the advantages of this technique is that we can use isotopic contrast, because the proton and the deuterium scatters the neutrons very different, and therefore we can be sensitive to different parts of the layers, or even we can make invisible the subphase or different things. So there are two different approximations: the full Q range, in which we can obtain the interfacial structure, and the measurements are around half an hour or 2 hours, and we can obtain the thickness of these interfacial layers, the composition perpendicular to the interface, and the interfacial roughness. Then we can use the low Q range approximation, in which we can get a real-time composition analysis of our surface. And it's just a few minutes of measurement. This means that we can know the quantity of polyelectrolyte and surfactant while we are applying the compression expansion cycle. So I want you to keep in mind the main objective of each technique. So set a potential measurements to determine the charge of the aggregates, surface tension measurements to study the dynamic behavior of these films, and measure the surface pressure while compressing and expanding. Then ellipsometry to get the amount of material at the air-water interface, and neutron reflectometry to study the interfacial structure and get a real-time composition of the films. And then remember that we can couple the Langmuir trough with ellipsometry and neutron reflectometry to do dynamic studies. So now I'm going to explain the results. First of all, we did the setup potential measurements, in which we determined the charge of the aggregates at a constant polyelectrolyte concentration varying the concentration of SDS. So as you can see, since the PLL is positively charged, the SDS is negatively charged, we see a decrease of the zeta potential of these aggregates while we increase the surfactant concentration. The charge neutrality is in 0.63 millimolar concentration of SDS, and we decided to study the positively charged aggregate with a charge of more or less 15, and this negatively charged aggregate with more or less minus 17 of zeta potential. So first of all, we wanted to see what was the effectiveness of the formation of these films in our system. So what we did is just an experiment in a Petri dish, spreading these positively and negatively charged aggregates at the air-water interface, and measure the surface pressure and delta, which, remember, that is the amount of material is related with the amount of material presented at the interface as a function of the time. You can see here this increase due to the spread of material, and then in the case of positively charged aggregates, we can see that the stabilization of both the surface pressure and the and delta is, we can say, fast respect to the other one. In 50 minutes, more or less, this is stable. In the case of negatively charged aggregates, we can see that delta, which is the black line, remains constant after 50 minutes, but in the case of the surface pressure, we can see a low increase in tendency that we have to do more experiments and think more about it to have an explanation of this different trend between the two different aggregates. When we have seen that we can obtain these films at the air-water interface in an effective way, we went on to study the dynamic behavior of these films. So now what we do was experiments in the Langmuir trough, studying the surface pressure of this system upon compression and expansion cycles, measuring the ellipsometry delta at the same time. So first of all, here I present the surface pressure area isotherms, in where you can see that we start here in this point, the black line. Then we start to compress the film, so we can obtain an increase of the surface pressure until we reach this point, which is known at the collapse. At this point, we are disrupting the structure of the film at the air-water interface, and we start to lose material into the body. And that's the reason why the surface pressure remains constant here. And then you can see that this tendency is more or less the same for all the cycles, while we can see some hysteresis for each cycle. This trend at the expansion, I will explain it later. But now let's focus on the initial values of pressure and delta for each cycle. Okay, you can see here that for the first and the second cycle, the final pressure for each cycle decreases with respect to the initial pressure. But then for the third, the fourth, and the fifth cycle, it seems to remain constant. If we go now and we see the values of delta corresponding to these values of pressure, we can see that there is more or less a decreasing tendency, but we have here in the fifth cycle this inversion tendency that we don't have an explanation now, but we think that to be sure of what is happening, we need the neutron reflectometry because it can give us a direct measurement of the amount of polyelectrolyte and surfactant in a real-time composition analysis. For the negatively charged aggregates, you can see that the tendency is more or less the same, but we have more hysteresis for each cycle. And in fact, if we go to the initial values for the pressure and delta, you can see that in the case of the pressure, we have a decreasing tendency, which can be related with the loss of material in each cycle. Now, if we see the values of delta, we can see here that for the first and the second cycle, it's decreasing. That is that we are decreasing the amount of material for each cycle, but then it appears to be, it seems to be constant for the next cycles. So again, we need neutron reflectometry to see what's happening there and if we lose a surfactant or polyelectrolyte or both of them. So now you can see here a figure in which it's represented the surface pressure area isotherms at the same time of the delta isotherms. So the red line corresponds to the surface pressure area isotherm of negatively charged aggregates, and the red dots corresponds to the delta isotherms of negatively charged aggregates, while the blacks are the correspondent to positively charged aggregates. As I was mentioning before, the surface pressure behavior of both aggregates is very similar, but if we go now to compare the amount of material upon compression and expansion, you can see that the amount of material in the case of positively charged aggregates is much higher than the one obtained with negatively charged aggregates. And then it's important to mention also that we can see here in this area of the green circle a squeezing out of material. So while we are compressing, we are increasing the amount of material at the air-water interface, but there is a point in the case of negatively charged aggregates where we can see a decrease on the amount of material. So here we are losing material into the bulk. And mention that this is reproducible over successive cycles for the negatively charged aggregates. Now I wanted to compare the system that we have used with the system that Andrea Tumino used in his PhD. And I will begin explaining the surface pressure area behavior. So in the case of PLLSDS, I already explained a little bit the isotherm, but in the case of NAPSS DTAP system, what we can see is that we spread the aggregate, we form the film, then we compress and we reach the collapse here. And then here we are expulsing material into the bulk. And this huge hysteresis that we can see from the first cycle to the rest of the cycle is related with a lot of loss of material into the bulk. And then the film behaves as a perfectly soluble membrane. In our case, we have a little bit of hysteresis on each cycle, and the behavior of the film is reproducible over successive cycles. So we went on to calculate the compressibility modulus by this formula, which can give us information about the elasticity or the compressibility of the film, and also about its physical state. So in the case of the NAPSS DTAP system, you can see that the compressibility modulus is increasing while we are compressing until we reach values of more or less 90 millinewtons per meter, which is related with the values typical for gel phases, or at least not fluid phases. And then when we reach the collapse, the compressibility modulus drops down to zero because we are disrupting the film, the structure of the film, and we are sending material into the bulk. And then for the rest of the cycle, we cannot see this tendency in the case of the NAPSS DTAP system. And as I was mentioning before, it behaves as a perfectly soluble membrane. If we go now to the results for the PLL-SDS system, we can see that this behavior in which we can reach the collapse and we disrupt the structure of this film and we send material into the bulk happens over successive cycles. So we believe that this expansion, in this expansion we are recovering material in each cycle. So if we do the same now for the same calculation for the expansions, you can see that in this case is very similar to the compression because they are perfectly soluble membranes. And in our case, we have this tendency which we believe that is related and give us an idea of the returning of material to the interface. You can see that we return to values of more or less 80 millinewtons per meter related with the gel phase before going to the expansion. While in this case, we don't have this tendency. So we believe that in this expansion, there is recovering of material. So the perspective of this project are, first of all, study this NAPSS DTAP system because the composition and the structure, well, the composition, yes, but the structure of these films has not been resolved yet. And especially the structure of these extended structures that are formed upon compression and expansion. And for that, we will use the full Q approach. Then we want to study to determine the surface excess of both the PLL and the SDS during compression expansion cycles using the low Q approach and the structure by full Q NR measurements. And for that, we have already a beam time proposal accepted. And we want also to use other techniques that can give us valuable information, such as Brewster angle microscopy and dynamic light scattering. And then we want to study also the influence of the pH and the ionic strength on the properties of our films. And I just want to mention finally that we are planning to use these nanoparticles because it has been shown that ligand-coated nanoparticles can be trapped at fluid interfaces and can respond to compression by forming percolated structures that are similar to the ones that we can obtain with polyelectrolyte surfactant mixtures. And we want to use gold nanoparticles because they have a lot of interesting optical properties. They have been used in pharmaceutical, medical applications, so they are biocompatible. And this is very important for our project. And it has been so that it is possible to control the adsorption of these nanoparticles at the air-water interface using surfactants, and this adsorption is irreversible. And then we want to see the influence of the charge, the size, and the shape, and different functionalization of these nanoparticles in the properties of the nanoparticles for future use in ternary PS nanoparticle system. And here I present some preliminary data that we have for gold nanoparticles, which are negatively charged in the surface. So they are hydrophilic, they remain in the solution, and CTIB as a surfactant, which is amphipathic, and it goes to the interface. If we do mixtures of these two components, the electrostatic interactions between the gold nanoparticle and the surfactant can make the nanoparticles being absorbed at the interface. And you can see here, just to mention a surface pressure area isotherm of these nanoparticles with surfactants and with the and only the surfactant, which we cannot see anything because the surfactant is soluble. But in the case of nanoparticles, we can see that there is the formation of this film at the air-water interface. And these results of the ellipsometry tell us that we have higher surface excess when we use gold nanoparticles with the CTIB than when we use CTIB. So we can say that we have these nanoparticles absorbed at the air-water interface. So that's everything. I would like to thank my supervisors, Armando, Jane, and Richard. I would like also to thank the partnership for Soft Condensed Matter for the use of the Lambert trap, the Zeta nanoizer, and the ipsometer. And I would like also to thank Andrea Santa Maria, a PhD student from the ILL, for all the discussions and the help with the presentation. And that's all. If you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Okay, yeah. Hi, Javier. Very nice presentation. Yeah, what I was wondering is, so this material is soluble. So how stable it is, and if there is a dependence on the speed of compression when you do your surface pressure measure?
Okay, that was a question that I was waiting for it, because indeed that is something that we want to see, which is the influence of the speed of compression in the behavior of our films. Because we believe that we maybe don't have, if we increase the speed of compression, we can make this material going faster into the bulk. But indeed, it's something that we want to see, because now we don't know it. I mean, I've just done these measurements at a constant speed of compression, not so fast. It was 7 centimeters squared per minute in this small trough that we have in the PSCM, but we want to study the influence of the speed of compression. So.
And out of curiosity, why do you reach the collapse? I mean, normally one would always avoid to reach the collapse of the film.
Why? Because yeah. In our case, it is very important, because it's after this collapse when we think that we can have the formation of the reservoir structures. Because if not, we have a membrane. So we want to see the formation of these structures that are like going into the bulk, but are in our interface.
Okay. Just final thing, out of curiosity, what's the size of the nanoparticles you use?
The size of the nanoparticles, I've done some experiments with 30 nanometers and 15 nanometers.
30 nanometers?
Yeah.
Okay, so they're rather big.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
And it has been also done for silicon nanoparticles, and it seems to work very well.
Okay, yeah, I'm just wondering with neutrons, if it's so thick, how good it is, but yeah, curiosity.
Okay, thanks.
Javier, I'm not familiar with a lot of these techniques. I found it quite interesting how you can measure surface tension, which I guess corresponds to a kind of two-dimensional energy density, sort of like pressure in 3D. Mm-hmm. So that was interesting. Surfactants lower, in general, they lower the surface tension, I believe. But what mm-hmm. I found interesting was the technique of measurement. And I forget what it's called. You had a slide on this. It's
the Lambert trough.
And I was just wondering if the technique, there it is, if the technique of measurement, this Wilhelmy plate.
Yes, it is.
Does it perturb the film, or is it simply very small, or does it remove a little bit of the material at the interface?
No, in principle, it's
characterized.
Optimized. So it's just a filter paper that you just put in contact with water. So you wait before the experiment. You have to put the paper in contact with just water, a clean interface, in such a way that the filter paper is completely wetted. And then your measurement of the surface tension cannot be varied because of the wetting of the plate while you are measuring. And there is no absorption of material, of our material. No, there is no absorption into the plate.
In order to measure the pressure, how is that done? Is it simply pulling on something?
Yes.
There's a piezoelectric that senses it? Or is there a manipulation, in other words, a vertical displacement of the Wilhelmy plate?
There is a vertical displacement. There is a microbalance in this pressure sensor. So you can measure this the force that the interface is doing to your plate. So then you can calculate the surface tension with some equations that takes into account the force that it's doing, the perimeter of the plate that you use, etc.
Okay, well, it's very small, and so it doesn't perturb very much the film. Okay, mm-hmm. And the displacement is small. Okay, the other quick question, I think, is you showed a transparency on ellipsometry, where you mentioned reflectivity. I think it's the reflectivity. Here it is, yes. I think this is it, but you also had a reflectivity one. Yes, this is it, sorry. Uh-huh. Now you're looking at particular reflectivity. Could it be interesting? Of course, it's more complicated, but could it be interesting for these systems to look at off-specular, either QX or QY, rather than just QZ that gives you information perpendicular to the interface?
Yeah, it could be interesting. But I mean, in principle, we want to see we want to determine the composition perpendicular to the interface because we believe that it is going to give us information about the structure of these reservoirs. And then this low Q approach has been well optimized with this specular reflectivity. So it helped us a lot to understand and determine the composition during the expansion and compression cycles. But yeah, why not? It could be interesting also to see the off specular reflectivity of this system.
Okay, let's all of us thank Javier again.